A teacher, I believe, can touch so many lives in that one single moment. As a teacher, the more I was teaching, I was also learning equally every day. Welcome to Great Principles. I am Seema Choria. I bring to you another legendary figure from the world of Indian Academia. Sometimes it feels that we spend our entire lives trying to return to who we were as children. The pressure of being an adult are plenty. These various roles that adults have to play by demand investments our time, emotions, efforts, and of course, finances. How carefree we were as children. Always curious and ready for new adventures, my guest today believes we have a lot to learn from children. Let them do things on their own while observing them carefully and watch them create wonders. Please join me in welcoming Mrs. Shipra Verma, Principal Gangotri International School, Gondal, Rajkot, Gujarat.
Thank you so much, Seema. It's great being here on the show. Thank you for having me here.
Thank you, ma'am. We're looking forward for an insightful discussion. So let us begin by knowing where it all started. So once upon a time, your belief in sharing knowledge and helping people through the learning led you to become an educator. Has this belief of yours stood the test of time as an educator?
It has. It has for sure. You see, when we girls, especially when we are young as tiny tots, we play games. And we mostly tend to become teachers in our role plays. And that's how I grew up thinking of becoming a teacher. And the moment I got married, I put myself into this job thinking that this is the best suited job for me. And it is. I started believing it day after day. I started living it day after day. And here I am. I'm doing the best for the cause of spreading education, spreading awareness among the masses. Because a teacher, I believe, can touch so many lives in that one single moment. And I have always felt that the day I'm happy, my mood is uplifted, I enter the class happy. And my children are like, yo, today we're going to have a good day. If I am stressed out as a person and go into the class as a teacher, and without knowing, I spread that same stress, unhappiness, in all the classes, wherever I'm going, because children are very, very sensitive. They immediately sense. I just hope that we can be as sensible as them. It's my wish to God, because as I told you earlier, that children are amazing and we have so much to learn from them. They have this amazing quality. They are innocent and at the same time, very, very sensible. Their perceptions are the way they perceive things, see things and understand things. It's much more pure and stronger than us adults. We become, I believe we become more convoluted as we grow up. We start hiding things. We start saying it lesser that, oh, you're looking good, or start giving compliments to others. It's something that we need to bring ourselves to that, oh, today I should compliment this person. Whereas children, you see, they're so pure and innocent. They'll just say, oh my God, you're looking so lovely. Your hair looks so nice. We as adults might think twice before saying this, that, oh, will it look a left-handed compliment? Should I say this to my junior or to my senior? That's how I feel. It's such a wonderful thing to be a child. And as much as I want to, we at this age can't be except for that replicating them or simulating their actions and behaviors. That's what I believe. And so I grew up not only professionally, but personally also. As a teacher, the more I was teaching, I was also learning equally every day. And I learned that it's not while teaching, we are not only dispensing something. Every day brings us a new learning, a new experience. And I grew up as an educator. So this belief of mine that I can be a teacher has landed me into this stage where I never call myself a teacher. I call myself a learner, and I am a lifelong learner. That's what I believe, Seema. All of us are. It's just the way we look at life.
Certainly. That is the trait, that is the best trait a leader can have, to be a lifelong learner. And this is the era when we all need to learn, relearn, and unlearn.
So much to learn. Even a lifetime would not, suffice it. There are so many things to learn. And being a teacher is wonderful. I have enjoyed every bit of it.
Certainly. And when you're so fond of, when you see children from a different lens, and when you're surrounded by them, that is what keeps you always young and always thinking differently.
Agile. Yes, yes. Because, when you are with children, then it gives you such an amazing feeling. You can be with them. You can think like them. And because of your experience in number of years, you can take them to a different world that gives you a completely different kind of a high that no other feeling can match to. Being with children is an amazing. It's a facility, I would say. It's a privilege that I've got. And I really ensure that I am giving my best to the society.
To me, and those beautiful innocent smiles immediately cheers us up. The entire fatigue just goes away when they just smile.
Yes, that it does.
Children, and beautiful experience to be with them. So great. Moving in our conversation ahead, I would like to know from you, starting out as a teacher, from where you have grown to be a leader, is surely a learning experience for you. Is mentoring necessary for acquiring skills that help you perform better at your work and life in general?
I started as a teacher, and after teaching for say around 8 to 10 years, I was promoted as the pre-primary headmistress of a school in Lucknow. It's a very renowned school, and I was kind of handpicked for that job when I was expecting that promotion in the least bit of it, that I would get that job, because the headmistress suddenly left due to some personal reason. And when my name was called out, it was like unbelievable for me. And that day, Seema, I learned that being a teacher, I thought it's a difficult job till then. But then I knew that being an administrator it gives you new avenues to learn. Because that day, that being a teacher doesn't only mean managing the students, but also managing the teachers, not only managing them, leading them, teaching them in a way that it doesn't, the tone is not didactic, but like, walking with them hand in hand like a friend. And I struggled for a couple of months, because being a workaholic, I got very less time for research and all that. But then I scheduled my time, and I learned that dealing with young minds, and then dealing with young minds who've grown up in their age. So you need different techniques. And that was the time I grew up professionally. And I also learned so many things about human behavior, about groups, their mindsets, and how to deal with them. And also, primarily, very importantly, I learned how to look at things objectively, without getting personal at it. The moment you are able to look at things objectively, it sets you, things are set in the right direction. And then, with a lot of empathy, kindness, understanding, it will definitely give a boost to your work culture. And children or teachers or your teammates, people will start working in that one sync which is required to give that much needed success. So that's how I moved ahead. And I realized that God has given me this opportunity for me to learn something.
Great. So what do you find easier, teaching children or guiding the teammates, teachers?
One is always teaching the students. Being in the class is an amazing, nothing matches it. There's nothing parallel to it.
Great, wonderful. And molding one mind is much easier, I suppose.
It's easier, and also that, when you go to the classroom, along with the students, you are also traveling to those places where you are trying to take your children to. So you get that facility to be a child once again. That's what I enjoy the most. And it's a community of learners, which at my age, I might not go back to school and study and enjoy those moments once again. But that one period in the day, that one lesson will give me that 40 minutes of high happiness and confidence as well.
Yeah, you know that being a people's person is not easy task. As you rightly said, you have to think twice whether you know you have to ensure that you're empathetic, you're kind. There are so many factors that you have to keep in mind when you're dealing with others. So yes, it's not easy to be in the position where she is and dealing this every day. It's not as easy as it looks.
You have to get into the minds of people. You see, the age group you're dealing with, the community that you're dealing with. You need to understand their needs, their thought processes, also some part of science, you see, because when you're dealing with pre-primary kids, it's different. But when you're dealing with the children of plus two level between age group 16 to 18 years, you need to think like an adult, you know, and also keep their hormones in mind while dealing with them. You cannot treat these two age groups similarly. So I have a lot of, psychology was never my subject, but because of my own interest, I have studied a lot of philosophy and psychology. And so it becomes easier for me to get into their minds and think like them and make them friends, you know, like just to, so as to understand what they are thinking and what should be my action plan to deal with it. The greatest thing an educator can do is to make the child comfortable. Unless and until the child is sitting comfortably with you, his or her brain is not open to learn. That child is sitting in, you know, eternal inhibition or fear or that thought that, oh, what if I don't complete my homework? Or what if I cannot answer? So the first thing I tell them, it's okay. Even I don't know everything. You know, I was just going through this signboard somewhere. I saw that welcome to so-and-so school. Our learners also just like you don't know everything in this world, which is a fact. And I keep on telling my students, it's okay. Even I don't know everything. So some sense of comfort when the child has, he or she will immediately feel comfortable, not only open for learning, but for other ventures too. So then it becomes easy for me as an educator to mold them or to prepare for, you know, some device, some strategies for them to deal with certain kind of issues, because then you get an easy access to the minds, the thinking processes, which helps you as a decision maker also to design some things.
Very well said, ma'am. And you know, that is the bond when you establish with the children, that is when they're not only open to learning, in fact, they create a small family with you.
Yeah.
They share a lot more with you and gain a lot more in terms of, you know, their humor, intellectual, beyond intellectual level. You know, they
Correct. They
open the psychological level to you, and that is where they shape up as a better citizen. So very well said, ma'am. It's very, very important for educators to connect with the child and make them feel comfortable.
It has always worked for me, always.
Yeah, it is. It has to be, because that is, you know, when the child feels secure that this is the person, my go-to person.
Yes,
I can always be with them the way I am. I need not change or behave like something else. It is me, and this is what makes me best. So
Yes,
absolutely rightly said, and I think all educators must practice this. The very first basic thing is to make the child comfortable, create a bond with them, connect with them, and that is when the learning will take place. So on this note, we move on to our next question, ma'am, which goes as: in a career, we all, you know, there is so many things that we get appreciated and recognized for the good work that we do. And that also reflects positivity in us when we are motivated with the kind of appreciation we receive. So which professional landmark of yours has made a lasting impact on your personal and professional achievements?
I mentioned this to you earlier also. When the first time I got this job of, I got this promotion, being the coming to an admin role. So I learned a lot of things, different things, and I learned them differently. I started looking at things from a different perspective. As a teacher, only as a teacher, I was too closed, too engrossed in my own pursuits of, you know, preparing materials, doing things and preparing for the lessons and plans and doing this and that and trips and all. But then the circle from micro to it became macro. I had a bird's eye view of what was happening, and that really helped me grow as a person. I learned so many things, and I was very fortunate to have some very good mentors who not only taught me how to go about it, but they were also always there with me at every step, gently guiding me, you know, just like a potter who works on a wheel and then prepares different things. So this particular arrangement, that then there was no stopping after that. I just moved ahead. I worked from the pre-primary kids to the senior children. I have trained teachers. I have prepared so many training modules. I have prepared, developed curriculum, and you know, all those things, policies and framework and, you know, implementation and teacher performance evaluation, many, many, many things. But luckily I had some of the best bosses I worked with, and I learned all the very good things from them. You know, when that, even when you've done something wrong and they look at you, look at them for affirmation and they smile back at you, then you know that it's okay. It's okay. That it's okay to, you know, sometimes go awry, things go awry or they go bad. But professionally, growing up is not, you know, it doesn't only need learning of assignments or things or performing day after day. It also is a lot of grit and determination not to give up, because there are, you know, things will not always go in the right direction. And then your personality, your character strength is tested again and again. So to be there and be there day after day in the same frame of mind, and then when you come out as a winner, that's the same thing you're transfusing or transpiring into the brains of your own team or your own students whom you're dealing with. So it's a process, you see. It can't be achieved overnight. Yes, you get a promotion or a post overnight, that's right. But your changing your entire thinking pattern is what gives you inner strength and courage, and then you know that yes, now I know. It's a new path, basically, you see. So treading on that, you need new pair of boots or maybe gum boots, otherwise you might slip or trip over. So that's the same thing that I would want to mention here again. And after that, there was no looking back. I got constant support from my elders and my seniors, and I have not looked back since. I have only put myself more and more into research and learned more about people, and learned that it is okay to make mistakes.
Very well said, ma'am. No, with position comes responsibility. It's not that you just, you know, as you mentioned, you get the position overnight, but you have to earn that later, that whether you were right fit for this or not. As soon as the position comes, it can go also. It's all about the consistency, the determination, the efforts that we put in to maintain that and go higher in our career. So it's not only about that what my bosses told me, it's also about how very well did I put in my efforts. So to all the team members out there, you know, we all get opportunities in life. Never quit. Keep on doing the best thing consistently, and then nothing but the best is going to happen. So this is what we have learned from ma'am's journey, a wonderful takeaway that keep doing. Consistency is the key to success. So wonderful thing, ma'am. I really, really love that point where you mentioned that it's all about being consistent.
Yes.
So going ahead, ma'am, to in our conversation, ma'am, we all have friends, ma'am, but there is one person, you know, with whom we can share and depend upon. Even if we'll go wrong, that person will handhold and, you know, take care of our back. So who is your guide you look up to for your advice and motivation?
I have worked with this principal of mine, Mrs. Raka Dixit, who's my mentor also, and with all due regards and respect, she has always been there. She has always been there, but she's my biggest critic also. And the first thing she'll keep tell me is that this is the problem with you. So it's good to have people like, you know, who keep you in check. And that's why I said that I have been fortunate enough to work with people who have always had my back. Very few changes in my career, but it's always a give and take, symbiotic. But for me, it has proven to be a little more than that. I believe I am fortunate enough to have received more than what I have given back. And that's how the universe works. So in that way, I have been lucky enough, and I have always learned wonderful things. And there are people to keep me in check that now, Shipra Verma, you are crossing the boundary and you might face the fatality. So you better be in check. And I always rever them enough to call them and ask that, ma'am, do you feel this is all right? Or, and the suggestions that come, they really help me. Mentoring is very, very important, you know, because whenever, see, in an institution or somewhere, whenever policies are made, they are made for the masses, not for exceptional people, you see. So for the masses, you need to mentor them. Whenever a new policy is made, masses need to be tutored about it. Tutored probably is not the right word, but yes, they need to be trained about it, mentored about it. A lot of hand-holding is required. I myself at this position do that day after day after day. But my way of doing it is a little different from others because I do this from a distance. I give them a lot of liberty. I do the same thing with my children. And I keep on telling them that ask me whenever you are in doubt, I'm always there. But this is your way. You will have to do it. These are the things that one should not do, but probably you might have a different idea of it. Try doing this. Because you never know when a new idea might click and something new comes up. Maybe I didn't know about that. So watching them from a distance, observing, and then when they fall, I have their back. That's how. But a lot of hand-holding is also required. Sometimes there are people who don't want to be left alone. You see, we have different kind of personalities we work with. There are some people who want me to be there with him all, with them always, and I make myself available to them. As a mentor, my mentors have always been available to me. And so am I passing on the same, in the same line, I'm passing the same legacy to my teachers. I'm always available 24/7 is what they know about me. And I love doing it. Every minute of it. Mentoring is something. Gives me a lot of satisfaction.
Certainly, I mean, that is what true leader is. One who empowers other, you know, to take a leap ahead. So, yes. And I actually really love the point where you mentioned that you need to have critiques in your lives. That those are the people, those who always wants best for you, because the one who can tell you that this is the place where you need to improve is the one who thinks for you, who wants you to go ahead in life. And we as humans also need to accept that. So that is the quality that you possess, that you accept it and take it in the spirit. Not many have this thing. You know, the person who criticizes, we will try to avoid that person. But that is the person with whom we should be very close, isn't it?
Yes, yes, that's right. That's right. It's in our benefit. It's for our good. And then there should be, like God, there is complete surrender. We cannot challenge his decisions. Similarly, a mentor is on earth, a guru, a mentor is God to us. And if I don't surrender, if I start asking or challenging his or her capabilities, then only God can save. वो कहते हैं हमारे लखनऊ में बोलते हैं ना कि खुदा आपका हाफिज है.
Right.
फिर अगर मैंने ऐसा किया तो फिर खुदा ही मेरा हाफिज है. मैं अपने मेंटर की कैपेबिलिटीज को चैलेंज नहीं कर सकती हूँ. That's how I feel about it.
And we all, you know, we have to keep faith and go ahead with the path shown by our mentor. If we do that, then there is no way ahead. We will be lost in our ways and there will be no one to guide us. So very well said, ma'am. We all need to follow this. So on this wonderful note, we reached a very interesting segment of the show. This is called rapid fire round. You have to answer in one word or maximum a sentence.
Okay.
So here goes the first question. You spend your recreational time indulging in activities like?
I go for trekking and I read.
Wonderful. So one thing keeps you your body fit and the other your mind. Amazing.
Yes, yes, yes.
Question. Your favorite travel destination?
Hampi.
Hampi. Who is your favorite author?
My favorite author is Milan Kundera.
All right. Rajkot is famous for, name the three things famous in Rajkot.
Rajkot is famous for its street food. Rajkot is famous for its food, street food, clothes, and some cafes, very good cafes.
All right. Last question of this segment. If given a wish to change one thing on this planet, you would wish to?
I wish there were no hungry people. It makes me really sad when I think of people sleeping without food. I feel that if I got one wish, then nobody would sleep hungry is what I believe. I can, if I can do this.
Beautiful thought. You know, a person can live without a shelter, but can't live without a food.
Yeah.
Beautiful and lovely thought. It was really good to know you in this segment, ma'am. We got to know some very interesting things about you. This brings me to the last question of the show. This is also called viewers' choice question. Our viewers keep sending in us a lot of questions, and this is the one which I have picked for you. Now you are actually emotional. We were planted, and you know, it actually troubles us when we sleep like peacefully, and there are so many out there who doesn't even
get me. So that's really troubles me actually, and I feel so helpless. In my own pursuits, I have never felt myself helpless. If in the education line, I always tell my bosses also, they might think that I'm too, but I'm too proud to say this. I believe there is nothing I can't do, I cannot do. There's nothing. But this is one thing where you feel helpless, you know. This, so that's how I feel terrible about it. I'm so sorry.
That's okay, ma'am. And you know, and there are a lot of philanthropist people, those who are taking a step in this, and they're trying to be a difference. But yes, it is a huge, huge issue today. Unless government do something about it, nothing can be done.
Yes, yes, correct. True.
It's the only government who can take this major step and make our wish true.
Yes, and people like us also, if we come together, if we join hands in our own capacities, I believe this younger generation is doing so many things. They are coming together to do things, but still there's a lot of it that needs to be done. Lot of it, which probably a single individual like you and me, we alone cannot do it. We need a bigger force, bigger mindset, changed mindsets to come together and do something for this society. You know, unless and until we are full on our stomachs, we can't think properly.
And these small steps are the, you know, the force behind the transformation that can take place in the future.
Yes.
Rightly said, we all can.
Yes, but together we can. Together we can.
Certainly. We can take a small step and do this. Wonderfully said, and a beautiful thought, ma'am. With this, the power of unity is something which can, you know, do anything impossible also. So, because even the word says, I am possible, right?
Yes,
together we can. So,
yes.
Wonderful. Now, coming on to the last question of the show, ma'am. Our viewers say that we all as parents wish to see our children to be best in everything. Regardless of what they are capable of, we expect them to be picture perfect and usually end up comparing them with other children who are better off with them. So what is your advice to parents and students alike on performance-based expectations?
Dekhi, parents aisa nahi samajhte hain ki, you rightly said that there is a race that is created, that my child is doing this. Your child, what is she doing in the summer vacations? This is a normal question that mothers ask their, you know, other mothers in a mother's meet or something. So there's an unsaid rivalry, competition. Hum log jab chote the, Seema, hamari chuttiyan 2 mahine, 2.5 mahine, 3 mahine ki hoti thi, and nobody would remember anything about the books and all. But nowadays, the moment the school closes, the summer camps will begin. Even the schools have started the summer camps because they know that the parents would want their children to. That, you know, that mindless competition, I am an educator, but I strongly believe that children should be left alone for some time. If you don't leave their brains alone to think, they will not be able to create wonders. We need more Einstein. We need more Thomas Alva Edison. और अगर उनके भी ऐसे summer camps हम करवाते रहते तो शायद वो ये ना कर पाते. मेरा कहने का मतलब ये है कि parents शायद ये realize नहीं करते हैं कि वो report cards, वो marks जिन्हें हम देख रहे हैं, वो उनको आगे life के challenges के लिए नहीं prepare कर रहे हैं. At the end of it, we should be more prepared with life skills, which the new education policy also talks about. And eventually, I'm sure we are going to do it. But in this transition phase, there's a lot of worry that goes into thinking that the mindsets of people should change, that mindless competition should stop. Grades will mean nothing if your child loses his or her mind in grade 12 or 11. And, you know, they just, sometimes children go berserk. They would want to leave everything and go for a specific cause or something, and parents don't understand this. ऐसा नहीं है कि नहीं समझते हैं, वो शायद ट्रेंड पे जाते हैं। तो मेरी पेरेंट्स से इतनी गुजारिश है कि वो ट्रेंड्स पे ना जाते हुए अपने बच्चे को सबसे बेहतर समझते हैं और वो उनके बच्चे उनकी सबसे प्रेशियस चीज है, सबसे अनमोल और कीमती चीज है। उसको वो जितनी अच्छी तरह से जानते हैं शायद हम लोग नहीं, एक टीचर जानता है या पेरेंट जानता है। उसको समझते हुए उसके लिए जो सबसे बेहतर है उसको एक कट एंड ड्राई करें विद द हेल्प ऑफ द स्कूल, बिकॉज आई बिलीव स्कूल इज ओनली सक्सेसफुल व्हेन पेरेंट्स एंड टीचर्स आर कंपैटिबल विद ईच अदर। दे हैव टू जॉइन हैंड्स, दे हैव टू प्रिपेयर अ चाइल्ड सेंट्रिक यू नो लर्निंग मॉड्यूल। लर्निंग मॉड्यूल आई डोंट ओनली इंटेंड टू से वी आर नॉट ओनली टॉकिंग अबाउट करिकुलर एंड को करिकुलर एक्टिविटीज, इट्स हाउ यू डील विद चिल्ड्रन ऑल्सो। इन अ क्लास ऑफ 40, आई नो दैट दिस चाइल्ड हू इज सिटिंग क्वाइटली एंड डज नॉट अटर अ वर्ड थ्रू आउट द डे इज एक्चुअली अ वेरी जीनियस चाइल्ड, बट ही माइट नॉट बी गुड एट आर्ट। तो पेंटिंग टीचर को हमेशा शिकायत रहेगी कि ये इसको तो सी ग्रेड आता है हमेशा, लेकिन साइंस में शायद 100 में 100 आते हैं। सो द एजुकेटर्स एंड द पेरेंट्स बोथ ऑफ देम दे नीड टू गेट टूगेदर, दैट्स वॉट पीटीएम्स आर अबाउट, पेरेंट टीचर्स मीटिंग, एंड डिस्कस द चाइल्ड, डिस्कस हिज और हर पर्सनैलिटी एंड देन फाइंड आउट वॉट काइंड ऑफ डायलॉग्स आर रिक्वायर्ड टू अपलिफ्ट द पर्सनैलिटी ऑफ द चाइल्ड। ग्रेड्स After, like at my age, I have to think and remember कितने परसेंट आए थे मेरे 10th में या एक स्पेसिफिक सब्जेक्ट में। किसको याद रहता है कि आपने after 10 years or 20 years of your job, who would remember आपने IIT से किया है या किसी छोटे इंस्टीट्यूट से BTech किया है। I mean, that's a wrong thing to say छोटे इंस्टीट्यूट, I mean, not so popular probably. It becomes immaterial unless and until you teach the right values to your child, you teach the right culture, unless and until you teach your child how to be rooted, it doesn't mean anything. No amount of degrees would suffice for it. जो मैं आपको एक example देना चाहूंगी, मैंने विपश्यना में ये सुना था तो मुझे लाजमी लगता है कि मैं आपके साथ share करूँ। जब हमारे ये नागासाकी और हिरोशिमा पे bombing हुई थी तो जिन्होंने वो एटम बम बनाया था साइंटिस्ट थे बहुत बड़े, उन्होंने बहुत पढ़ाई लिखाई की और चैंपियन थे क्योंकि उन्होंने एटम बम बनाया और उन्होंने कहा मैं खुद जाऊंगा जब आप ये ड्रॉप करेंगे एटम बॉम्ब्स, एंड ही सॉ दैट डिस्ट्रक्शन हैपनिंग व्हेन द बॉम्ब्स वर ड्रॉप्ड, ही वाज देयर इन द प्लेन एंड आफ्टरवर्ड्स दैट पर्सन कमिटेड सुसाइड बिकॉज ही कुड नॉट लिव विद द मेमोरी ऑफ ऑल दैट डिस्ट्रक्शन। Now, my question is that to myself, which I keep on thinking again and again, is that after all that education, he had things on his fingertips as a student. He was a champion. लेकिन उन्होंने क्या बनाया? मानवता को विध्वंस करने वाला एक ऐसा हथियार जिससे आने वाली इतनी ज्यादा generations भी affected रही। अगर उनके values सही जगह में होते तो वो कभी भी ऐसा आविष्कार करने को तैयार नहीं होते कि जिससे हम पूरी मानव जाति का समूल विनाश कर रहे हैं। सो आई एम ट्राइंग टू मेक अ पॉइंट हियर, इट इज मोर इम्पॉर्टेंट टू बी नाइस, टू बी कल्चर्ड, टू बी मॉरली स्ट्रॉन्ग। जब तक हम ऐसा नहीं करेंगे हमारी सोसाइटी ऊपर उठने से धीरे धीरे दैट प्रोसेस विल बिकम स्लो। एंड दिस इज वाई आई फील दैट पेरेंट्स इंस्टेड ऑफ लुकिंग एट द मार्क्स दैट द चाइल्ड हैज गॉट, they should check the knowledge and understanding of the subject. And it is just fine, you know, to not get very good grades. It is okay. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter. It's just an exam.
When I hear you, I'm pondering a little more, ma'am. And there is something which is hitting me very, very hard. That is, how did this mindset build? Aren't we all responsible for this? We boast about the marks of our children, be it at school level or parents. We proudly say that, you know, 99.8%, 99.9% in newspaper. Yes. Outside the school, there are big hoardings with the pictures. So parents feel, why not my child is there on the hoarding? So aren't we all collectively responsible for this?
We all are to be blamed for it, Seema. We all are to be blamed for it. We have in some rat race over a period of time, the schools, the society, the parents, in a very humongous manner, we have developed this culture that exists everywhere. In all the streets, nooks and corners of our society, people are only striving to get better percentage, better scores. Look at the cutoff lists that are going on in colleges, Delhi University, and you know, so many other places. Children are facing depression. Imagine, it's such a heavy word, depression, because they got 99%. And they could not score admission in some reputed college they were looking for. So we all are to be blamed for it. But I see a ray of hope, because this generation, the new generation, is thinks very well and has got a very curious attitude towards saving the environment, saving the globe from destruction, and has got a very good sense for all these things when it comes to social issues. And to an extent, they are dealing with it pretty well. It's just a matter of 10 to 15 years, and I think we are moving ahead in the right direction. I hope I'll be alive to see that change in society, but at least there's a prayer in my heart that says that, you know, everything should be valued and respected, and this will only come from the family. So there is this this attitude that we need to change, where we start not only respecting each other in the family, but also show other people with respect that this is your milk wala bhaiya. So do not call him by tu or something. You know, this all starts in the family.
Right.
That is the first school that the child attends. And then later on, the school joins hands with parents and we start bringing up the child. But I am 100% sure, Seema, this is possible. The mindsets can be changed. It developed over a period of time and it can recede also. I am very hopeful with the younger generation, the kind of studies which are going on, the kind of, because nowadays learning is more research oriented and children are learning things on their own, more hands-on experience, and they are you know, they are very verbose in their opinions which they are creating on their own. Their minds do not get influenced like we were influenced in my younger age by our elders and all. And we teachers and parents have a very serious role to play in this, that we guide them in the right direction.
Certainly, very, very well said, ma'am. You know, parents play a huge role, and हमारे parents आप सभी को ये बात समझने की ज़रूरत है. जैसे कि ma'am ने बताया, grades नहीं decide करते हैं कि आपके बच्चे का character क्या है या उसका मतलब आप grades, marksheet को अपना prestige sheet समझना बंद कर दीजिए. It is not the future of your child. Yes, एक tension pressure रहता है हमारे ऊपर कि university में admission कैसे मिलेगा, and that government is taking a step by making an open education sort of policy wherein child can take up whatever he wants to learn. And now with the virtual learning, doors are open, the world is open for us to learn. So, you know, there are so many universities out there. जैसे कि मैम ने बोला, कहीं से भी पढ़ा हो 10-15 साल बाद, that doesn't matter. And now the companies are recruiting people with creative thinking and logical reasoning. They are no more influenced by the mark sheets. So that is again a step forward. As ma'am, you rightly said, the change is coming in and we all are looking forward to it. And yes, we together can guide our children, because just imagine the condition of mind of an average student, what he must be thinking all the time, what pressure he must be going through. It's yes. Too much.
Together we can.
I totally agree to that. And yes, to all my parents, to all my teachers out there, let's together take the step and ensure that our children are not learning for examination. They're learning to actually educate their heart, mind, soul, and be a better citizen. So on this wonderful note, we are ending this session, ma'am, and it was really lovely to have you. I learned so much, and you know, you made me realize it's so good to be a child always when you're pure.
Thank you so much. Thank you. It was such a pleasure having me here on the show. I'm really obliged and feel really happy to be here. Thank you so much for calling me.